So what we'll do is we'll first do a little bit in memory of Surajit, who passed away on the 18th, very unexpectedly. And he was a very close friend of so many of us here that I thought this would be the right opportunity to reminisce a little bit about a dear friend who was so full of life and so caring and just a breath of fresh air. I always thought of him as my brother from another mother. We had almost the same names. My first wife and his wife had the same name. And we used to laugh that our daughters ended up being named different. And we managed to miss each other for the first 30 years of our lives. So, because I left very early and we didn't overlap anywhere. So here is actually one of his sketches that you see.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
He was an absolutely phenomenal artist. I really don't know what he did to make things come out this way. And now these are some pictures that I put together, mostly from his Facebook page. He was a Facebook friend, like many of you are. This is Surajit when I first met him around that time. And this is him in more recent times. And this one was in Germany last summer when he got stuck. He had gone to bring his daughter back from Lübeck. And here is something from his webpage, just so that those of you who did not have the good fortune to know him, see a little bit about his track as he went through the system and matured into the formidable force that he was in the community, both as a scientist and as a human being and as a buddy. So, with that, I would request Professor Chandan Das Gupta to say a little bit about him and give it to him. He had known Surajit far, far longer than I did. And it would be only appropriate that he can take it away. So Chandanda, it's all yours.
Yeah, you can hear me, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So, what can I say? It's really difficult to talk about the passing away of a dear friend and colleague, Surajit Sengupta, whom I have known for more than 20 years. Surajit was a brilliant physicist and a wonderful human being. It was actually a pleasure and a privilege to actually know him. Certain details of his, I guess many of the people in the audience today actually know him, so I don't have to say very much about his academic career and so on. But just to a few things that was already there in the slide, so I mean, not repeat very much. He was a PhD, he did his PhD in the early 90s from the physics department of Indian Institute of Science. I came to know him at that time when I was also working there. Then he went to Germany for postdoc and then eventually returned to India and worked at various places, which I've given here in the slide that Shrinis has prepared. And then during the last 10 years or so, he has been at TCIS Hyderabad. He was a brilliant physicist and his work was mostly in the area of classical statistical physics with emphasis on properties of solids, in particular phases and phase transitions in solids. I'll just say a few highlights of his research career. He started out doing a very important work on the density functional theory of freezing. And then this framework was used to understand the melting of the vortex lattice in high temperature superconductors. He also did very important work on laser-induced freezing in colloids, martensitic phase transitions. Most recently, one of the things that he has been working on for several years now, and he was very excited about this work, was trying to understand the role of non-affine displacements in various properties of both crystalline and amorphous solids. And actually, He passed away, as Shrivit mentioned, he passed away a couple of days ago, very early morning, on Thursday, Indian time. And he actually, this is his, this happened within about half an hour after he ended giving an invited talk at the APS March meeting, which is online this year. So he was actually giving a talk on his work on this non-affine displacements and how they affect the properties of solids and so on. And then he was listening to the other talks that were there in the session. And suddenly he felt unwell, and within about 15 minutes, he basically passed away. There was nothing that one could do, and there was not even a possibility of taking him to a hospital. His wife and his daughter were with him when this happened. And I guess, you know, this the whole thing is such a tragic thing and such a shocking thing to most of us who actually knew Surajit and had the was fortunate enough to know him well and to be friends with him. A few sort of personal notes, my interactions with Surajit. As I just mentioned, I met him in the late 80s when I came back to India from the US to take up a position at IISc. And he was a graduate student in our condensed matter theory group. And we started doing some work together. And this work was on the melting of the vortex lattice, which was very well received by the community. And it was really a pleasure to work with him, work with Surajit, who was, as I said, you know, always very enthusiastic about his work. And he was also quite brilliant in working out the various things that needed to be worked out. After that, for several years, we didn't do any work together, but we were always in touch. Our research interests had some overlap, so I would always meet him and talk to him at conferences or during visits and so on and so forth. And then subsequently, we also ended up doing some work on supersolids in supersolidity in helium. One thing that sort of also in addition to his sort of academic brilliance, the thing that sort of I remember most was his enthusiasm for whatever problem he was working on at that particular moment in time. And I remember that he was so excited about his work on this non-affine displacements that he would often call me up and tell me about the new things that he has found using this particular formalism. And there are still many, many new things to be worked out in that particular area. And I hope that, you know, his colleagues and students, ex-students, they will actually take this work forward in time, which will be a fitting tribute to Surajit as a physicist. I just also want to mention a few things about his personal qualities. As I said, he was a wonderful human being. He was warm, kind, and always jolly, always. He was always in a good mood. It was always a pleasure to spend some time with him. He had many interests, and other than physics, which he did very well, as Surajit just mentioned, he was an excellent painter, and we see one of his creations here. He was also a good sitar player when he was young. I mean, eventually he sort of gave it up because he got too much involved in doing physics, so he didn't pursue that, but he was very knowledgeable about Indian classical music, particularly the Hindustan classical music. And more recently, he had picked up the hobby of bird watching and photography of birds. And he actually, there are many beautiful pictures that he shared with me. And last time I met him was actually about a year ago when we had gone for a conference in Bhubaneswar. And the organizers then had taken us to a bird sanctuary. And Surajit took many pictures and beautiful pictures. And then we had a good time looking at those pictures. So, I mean, you know, I have many pleasant memories of, extremely pleasant memories of spending time with Surajit. And it will be very difficult to sort of come to terms with his sudden and untimely and tragic death. This will also be a big loss for the statistical physics condensed matter community, both in India and abroad. So I guess, you know, that's all I can say. And, you know, all you can do is to sort of appreciate having him as a colleague and a friend for many, many years. And this should have lasted for many more years, but unfortunately it didn't. So I guess that's all I have to say at this point.
Thank you, Chandanda, for the wonderful summary that you presented about him and your recollections about somebody that meant a whole lot to us. In fact, this morning we had email exchanges with Sato and Madan and you and I, and that was actually very therapeutic for, I can personally say for me, and I think same for all of us, because the last 48 hours have been difficult for us, difficult in ways that I cannot measure or describe. I've literally felt unwell at times, just hearing and thinking about what it was, I mean, thinking about what it was that happened. So if any of you want to say a few words, please do so, and then we will get started, because this is such an unusual event to lose somebody so special. And in fact, he used to attend these talks from time to time. He would just randomly show up and spend half an hour, 40 minutes, pick up whatever he needed to pick up, and he would disappear. So he was on my list of people I wanted to invite. That sadly never happened. But do you want to say anything?
Yeah, I can just say, I mean, mostly what Chandanda has said already, that, you know, I mean, not only just as a, you know, very versatile and extremely good physicist, I mean, you know, his warmth was something that one cannot forget. I mean, you meet him once. I mean, of course, I know him for the last 30 years, but every time we met, he was always in such a, you know, really jolly mood, and you know, you immediately feel happy looking at him, and that was the, you know, great thing about Surajit, actually. And we used to all call him Gambo, of course, by his pet name. And it's something, every time we met in conferences, it was he had such a presence that it was just unbelievable. And I still cannot believe it that you know, in fact, I met him last time, was last 2 years back, I think it was in a meeting in ISI, Indian Statistical Institute in Calcutta, and you know, we after the conference, we almost the whole night we had Adda in his room, basically. And that was really, you know, I simply cannot express my feelings. I mean, this was so sudden and tragic and really unbelievable. I mean, I just hope that that his wife and daughter will come to, you know, will find relief from the pain in due course of time. I mean, that's all only we can say. I mean, but we'll certainly miss him very, very dearly, I mean, for sure. Yeah.
Thank you, Shastra. With that, let's move on. Thank you again. Today, actually, our original speaker was supposed to be Roland Geyer, and Roland ended up having a terrible shoulder injury and a subsequent surgery that put him out of action. And I learned it pretty early, and so I requested Mukesh Tiwari. Mukesh is somebody I've known for a very long time, since he was a graduate student at the University of New Mexico with Professor Nitant Kenkre, who had promised to attend Mukesh Ambani's talk, but he didn't show up. Anyway, Mukesh is a professor at Dhirubhai Ambani Institute in Gandhinagar. And he and I, we started collaborating many years ago, and he has been doing some really cool work. And this is about describing systems that are that are potentially capable of hang on, my screen is going bonkers here. I can't seem to get it under control. Yeah, okay. So let me just formally introduce him and go there. So the title of Mukesh's talk is Partisan Competition and Strategies in Election. The word partisan actually came from a political science colleague of ours, because in his lingo, what we are doing with sort of a randomizing model, random fieldizing model, is actually a partisan competition study. So the title came from there, partisan competition and strategies in elections, an Ising model-based study. And as I mentioned, Mukesh is a associate professor at Dhirubhai Ambani Institute of Information and Communication Technology in Gandhinagar in India. And a brief bio, he did his BSc from Delhi University and MSc from IIT Delhi. And his PhD, as I mentioned, from the University of New Mexico with Professor Kenkret. His PhD work focused on fundamental problems in non-equilibrium statistical mechanics and nonlinear models of microscopic friction. Some of his more recent research directions have been in impact propagation, absorption, and dispersion in structured and amorphous granular materials and statistical mechanics-based studies of complex social phenomena. So with that, Mukesh, let me turn it on to you, and you go ahead and put your slide up.
Thanks. Okay, is the screen visible?
Yes, yes, and thanks everyone for being with us as we remembered a very dear friend. I'll shut up now, you're ready to go.
Okay, so yeah, thank you, Zasen, and also giving me the opportunity to discuss some of the explorations that we have been doing on partisan competition and strategies in elections. This work is in collaboration with Shi Guang and Professor Sen at Sunny Buffalo. So let me just start by giving you the idea and motivation, at least my motivation, behind what you are, what we have been doing. And I'll try to set it up in the context of Indian elections, and particularly the last two elections. So India, as most of us we know, it has two main national parties. One is the Congress and other is the BJP. In 2009, a Congress-led alliance was in power, and in 2014, the BJP came to power. The 2014 elections has a lot of significance, I would say. And some of the important observations that one can make in the context of 2014 elections is that after 30 years, for the first time, there was a majority-led government. BJP on its own, it got majority. So that is the first observation that I would like to make. The second observation is that even though BJP got majority on its own in the elections, the share percentage of its vote, it was the smallest for any party which formed a majority government. The third, and I'll tie it up with the second point that I have made, is if you look at the map from 2009 and compare it to 2014, so 2009 map, all these blue areas are essentially the Congress-led, where the Congress won. And the saffron would be where the BJP won. So in 2014, what happens is that BJP goes in and wins in a lot of Congress-dominated areas. Since the vote share was not very large, so it got around 31% of the votes. So it essentially the win margin, it's not very, very large over there. In 2019, the situation is different compared to 2014. 2019, BJP is already in power for 5 years. People know their style of governance, the way they think. But more importantly, there were certain actions of the government, certain implementations that they had done, which had caused hardships to the people. If you if one goes back and looks at the some of the pre-poll surveys that were done, most of them what they were predicting was that BJP is going to win, but the numbers would not be comparable to that in 2014. However, what happened was not only did BJP won, it swept the elections. It retained most of the constituencies, the seats that it had won in 2014, and also was able to win in regions which till that point of time, till the previous elections, was not accessible at all to BJP. So if I were to think about what happened in 2014, and I'm going to elaborate it on a little bit on this thing. 2014, there was, of course, a wave, or not a wave, but something against the incumbent government. So the sentiment was against that. But the winning margin, since it was quite low in many places, this indicates that what the BJP was doing, it was in fact trying to strategize at a very, very small scale. So this was what it was trying to do. Let me just summarize some of these things, and hopefully this will give a better feel for what I am trying to say. In 2014, the voter sentiment, as I said, it was largely against the incumbent government because there were issues of corruptions, and BJP came with this whole idea of inclusive development, and all these things were there. 2019, the dissatisfaction was there on a few issues, but the scale was not as large as in 2014. Also, another change that happened from 2014 onwards is that the elections became person-centric rather than being party-centric. So BJP used this idea of Modi being a clean person who is a very strong leader, pro-development, while the opposition, they talked about him being a polarizing personality, but it started becoming more about a personality. From 2040 onwards, what one sees is that the campaigns have become increasingly aggressive. There is extensive usage of social media and other digital media platforms. And as I mentioned a while back, the national level campaigns, they are supplemented very, very strongly by local level strategies. In fact, one of the things that they talk about when it comes to BJP is that they are always in the election mode, and they try to go to the smallest scale at the booth level and try to start from there. In 2014, what one also observed was that there was a lot of inter-party convergence. Many leaders from Congress, they moved into BJP. Another thing that was there in the 2019 elections was the issue of terrorism leading into nationalist sentiments and the action taken by the government. They became quite important for the elections during the time of the elections. In February of 2019, there was a terrorist attack on Indian armed forces. And subsequently, there was a strong response by the government, and people had a lot of emotional attachment to that. Such kind of events, I am going to think of them as extreme events in the context of what I am going to discuss. If I were to compare the Indian elections with that of the last two US elections, for instance, I do notice a lot of similarities between the observations made in the context of Indian elections and in the context of US elections, even though these democracies are very different and the kind of issues that dominate the elections are significantly different. In 2016, just like Modi was a complete outsider as far as the Indian national politics was concerned, Trump comes in as a complete outsider. He uses social media extensively. He is also somebody who is an aggressive campaigner. And the way that the win happened, one of the explanations to the win in many places, especially the swing states, was that he was able to align people who had these unaddressed grievances to his side. 2020 election, US elections, there also one sees that the swing states do in fact favor some of them to the winning president, Joe Biden. But the issues that are dominating here, so the campaign is equally aggressive. It was very aggressive over there. But the issues that are generate that were dominating, apart from the regular ones that one sees during elections, there was the issue of COVID management, for instance, and race and ethnic equality, like Black Lives Matters and things like that. These, again, in the way that I am thinking about it, these are extreme events which generate emotional response very quickly. And then there is this whole state of Georgia going to the Democrats, because Georgia, for the longest time, it was considered to be a Republican strong. So if I were to just look at these two elections, I see that the strongholds shifting their allegiance, that's one thing that is noticeable. Extreme events having some implications as far as the elections are concerned, another. Aggressive campaigning, local grassroots level campaign building, this is another thing. Convergence, in the case of India, moving from Congress to BJP, for instance, in the case of US in 2020 elections, many of the centrist Republicans, them favoring the them not favoring the not favoring Trump. So let me put it in that way. And then in many places, these absent voters, or many elections rather, them playing an important role. So if I were to think about it, there are all these different factors that are playing a role as far as the elections are concerned. So given all these things, our aim was to come up with a model for partisan competition and voter decision making. And the objective of this is that the model should be general enough, and general enough in the sense that it is able to model the prevalent state of the electorate, for instance. And the prevalent state, for instance, would mean that before the campaigning begins, what is the state? What is the general feeling of the voters? It can include these effects of these inter-party conversions, absent voters, short-term aggressive campaignings, and also these extreme events which have a strong emotional effect. So that is what we were thinking, or that is where I'm coming from. So in order to generate this whole thing about voters' choice, so if one were to go back and look at the political science literature, so the voters' choice is essentially dominated by long-term factors and short-term factors. Long-term factors would include partisan loyalties, their ideological orientations, the social characteristics, and things like that. And the short-term factors, they lead to fluctuations. And these would include, for instance, government performance, candidate profile, presence of extreme events, and things like that. While there are these, all these different factors that have a role to play in the way that the voters finally make the choice, how it influences them, that is not very clear, or the magnitude of the impact might also be not very clear. But usually there are two channels in which one can assume that they influence. One is the direct influence, which just directly hits me. I'm very particular about something and I see it, and that hits me directly. This would be, for instance, if you have heard Professor Ghulam talk, his whole idea of prejudice would come under this. Then there could be also what one calls the internal influence, where it's the social group which essentially has a role to play in the kind of opinion that is being formed. When it comes to the way in which the social group forms the opinion, one of the most widespread theories is by Bibb Latani that was given in 1981. And it's called the social impact theory. And what it essentially says is that the influence of a source on a target, it depends on three factors. What, the first is the strength, how strong is the source. The second is how close it is, immediacy. And the third is the number that is going to be there. How all this is going to influence would also depend on the type of person that one is thinking about, and I call them to be social players. So whether they are conformist, they are contrarian. So conformist mean that they take the opinion of the local majority. Contrarian would be the ones we usually see a lot in academic circles, for instance, who usually take the opposing opinion. And inflexibles are the ones who usually don't change at all. So they are decided, they are staunch supporters for a certain political party. So with all this, we try to construct our model, and the model is quite simple. So the first attempt, the first thing that we do, so basically there are two models that I'm going to talk about. The second is just the extension of the first. The whole idea is the standard Ising model of physics, where one has both the internal influence and the external influence. The internal influence, we assume it to be nearest neighbor based. So we are looking at a two-dimensional Ising spin system. And for simplicity, we are taking the values to be discrete, plus one and minus one, for and against, or support for this one party and the other party. And to begin with, I'm going to assume that the interaction strength is larger than zero. So this would imply the conformist attitude. So if majority of my neighbors, they have the say, they have a certain opinion, I would take their opinion. All the factors that influences directly, we are going to treat them as external factors. So this would be like the external field that is being applied on the Ising model. One does not expect that the influence of the external events, and whatever they are, I'm keeping it quite general right now, they are going to be the same for everybody. So what we do is we take it to be a random number, uniformly distributed between values. We have given a positive tilt to it. And what we do is we only apply it for a short time. The reason why the thought to apply it for short time is one of the reason is that in today's times, information reaches people quite fast. So whatever that external thing is, that influence is going to, that information is going to reach very, very fast. And the response to that external influence, the personal response is also going to be quick. Beyond that, it's the local factors, it's the interactions which will lead to the final state of the system. So what we have is, in the absence of anything which is external, a conformist model, a local conformism, the external factor, them being represented by a random field to mimic the effect that the influence is going to vary between people. Since information is very, very fast, we take it to be a short term. Now, what we do from here is that we try to generate First, the prevalent state of the system. So let me just show to you what we are trying to do. And our observable is going to be magnetization, or the average value of the spin, where N is the total number of spin sites. So we start from some state. We are going to apply the random field for some time. And then we remove the field and let the local interaction, it lead to the state of the system. So what one observes is that as we apply this random field, the randomly distributed spins, they start forming clusters. This is something that I think this is known, the way these clusters are formed. And slowly the smaller clusters, they start merging into the larger clusters with these large domains, the white and black representing the plus and minus. They start to form. However, what happens is when the field is removed, the magnetization just doesn't change drastically. It stays at the same value. So it's a very, very small, slow change that happens for a significant amount of time. So what we do is that given some external influence, we assume that this is going to be the prevalent state of the system. And we ask the question, how stable are these two perturbations? And we think about two perturbations that could one can apply. One is the presence of events which evoke a opposite response. And to keep matters simple, what we do is any perturbation, we only apply in the largest domain and do not worry about the smaller domains at all. So that's the first perturbation that we think about. So these could be some campaigning, some events which are in the opposite direction to the state in the largest domain. And we represent it via these inflexibles. We put them in the largest domain and then see what happens to this prevalent state of the system. The second is about these absenteeism, where we make a percentage of the spins in the largest domain as absent, and then see the effect of those perturbations. So here, what I'm showing is that we decide on a critical value of the when we remove the external effect, and then the let the system evolve on its own. So that's the curve that we are showing for different values of cutoff values. And this is in the average sense, that in the sense that we are taking averages over many, many systems. And then we select one of them. So in this case, what we do is we select a cutoff value of 0.3 or 0.4 where it's sort of stable. And then we try to see the effect of perturbations. So the first one is when we include the inflexibles. And as one includes the inflexibles, what happens is that the larger domain, it doesn't remain stable. And the ones that is surrounding it, it starts to move in. And if the fraction of these inflexibles is pretty large, then the change in the other direction, that is also going to be quite large, or quite fast. The second one is we allow, the only change that we are doing is that some of these spins, we don't represent it. So they are absent. And then we let the system evolve. Here also, it's not very stable, but the change is quite slow in the other direction. But the important point of this is that if one is trying to think only in terms of conformism, and then the change that is being inflected is in terms of these inflexibles and absence in the larger domains, then the system is quite unstable to these kind of perturbations. And what happens is that it immediately goes to the other side. However, there are a few limitations as far as the model is concerned. The first one is that conformism it represents only a single type of behavior. Society is not made up like that. The second is that the system will always go to a complete consensus. That is always going to be the final state of the system. So that is also largely unexpected. Also, the way we are trying to create support for one, or that prevalent state that I am talking about, is via these external events that is not intrinsic to the system, that is external to the system. And that is not stable. So any change that we try to do into that, it does not really oppose that change in any way. I can take the cutoff value to be anything, to be a large number also. So that would, in fact, if I take the cutoff value to be significantly large, then what it would mean is that it's signifies a lot of support for one, but then even the smallest bit of perturbation makes the opinion slide to the other side, which one really doesn't expect to happen. So the question was, at this point of time, is there a way to come up with a model which shows more of this, in which we can incorporate more of this local cohesive behavior, and it doesn't really respond to the perturbations in that way. So the first thing that we did was we introduced the contrarians in the model. So earlier we only had conformists, and now we also include contrarians. The way that we do think about contrarians is we define this whole notion of strong versus weak local majority. So if you're thinking of just a simple Ising spin system each one having four neighbors, then if all the neighbors have the same state, then I would call it a strong local majority. Otherwise, it will be a weak local majority. So here in the figure over here, this would for me be a weak local majority. And in the case of weak local majority, we define a number which we call P sub C. And with probability P, so if we generate a random number, and if that value is larger than this P sub C, then it will behave as a conformist. Otherwise, it will be a contrarian. And just with this additional feature, if we try to see what happens, then for low values of PC, the parameter PC, the system will behave like a conformist or the previous system that we have talked about, in which leads to complete consensus. However, as this value of PC increases, the disorder increases, and then it can go to all being, so it never settles to a conformist state, because what would happen is that as soon as, so let's think in the situation when this value is equal to one, when everyone is conformist, unless we start with a complete consensus state, what is going to happen is always in the local neighborhood, there will be weak majority and a weak local majority, and it will keep on flipping. But my local cohesion that I am thinking about, that is still not included in this. And in order to do that, I go back to the social theory of Biblatani and think in terms of the strength and immediacy. So how these strong opinions, cohesive groups, they are being formed. And the way that we do it is by including inflexibles in the model, But these inflexibles come, or they have a stronger influence. So what we assume is that they are going to have stronger local influence than the others. So in principle, what we are saying is that wherever the inflexibles are present in their local neighborhood, the conformist attitude or the conformism will be stronger compared to the other places. Let me show you what happens as we change the level of or the number of inflexibles. So on the left is the situation when we do not have a lot of inflexibles. So let me just wait up here. So when there are not too many inflexibles, what happens is, and I'm doing the simulations in the case of if there is a weak local majority, then it is completely contrarian. So in that case, the system levels really settle down and we have all these areas which can be treated as more flexible to any external influence. However, if we have, many of these inflexibles, which basically signifies high cohesion, then the number of these or the areas in which the flexibility is higher, they are going to be quite few. And bringing in a change in this kind of system is going to be extremely difficult. So what we have essentially done is by using contrarian, inflexibles, and conformist, we have tried to create a model which is quite general in the sense that based on the values of the different parameters. These are essentially the fraction of the inflexibles which have a binding effect. And then the contrarians in the case of weak local majority, which will lead to this more flexible behavior. We can model systems which have different levels of cohesion. So even if, let me put it that way, even if the contrarian nature is large, so P sub C is one, but as we keep on increasing the number of inflexibles, then most of the, because these have the binding effect, then most of the neighborhood will align with the direction of the inflexibles. And these will be a very strongly bound society, electorate, whichever way we want to look at it. In the other case, if I were to, here what I have done is, I have not kept the number of inflexibles to be large, but if I were to just tune the contrarian behavior. So on one side of it, if it is completely equal to zero, then we have the pure conformist behavior. Then it just behaves like our Ising spin system, the first model that I had talked about. But as we slowly increase it, then beyond a point, what happens is that it can generate prevalent state with different levels of support for a party. However, over here, since the number of inflexibles, they are not large in this example. This is the Q equals to 0.05 over here. These would be more susceptible, or such kind of societies would be more susceptible to any external change than the one on the figure on the left. In fact, what we can say is that the stronghold of a certain party would be the one where we have many of these inflexibles or these binding forces in them, which would be very hard to break. Whereas if the number of inflexibles are not large, then it's more easier, in a manner of speaking, to change the opinion to the other side. And this might be what one can think of as in swing regions. Just to give you an example, because one can then start and with different configurations and play around with it. I'll just show one of them. So what we do over here is we take some value of the inflexibles, which is not very large in this case. We keep different levels of contrarian behavior. So in here, it's point, three cases, 0.5, 0.75, and 1. And all these values are essentially from here, from the from 0.5 onwards. So this is not very large number over here. And then the campaigns, one can think about it in terms of external events. There's no way in which one can measure the what that magnitude of the campaign is going to be. All that we know is that in many cases, it's quite aggressive. In many cases, the issues are something that people align with. But beyond this, we don't know much. So what we have done is essentially taken up multiple values over here. The campaigns, they run during the election season. So we don't want to keep that duration for which these campaigns run. The way we represent these campaigns is, again, via the random field idea, that it's going to influence each one differently. So the figures are for different values of the random field, but there is one more thing that we are doing with it. So first, if you focus on the figure on the bottom right, here what I have done is I have taken the maximum field values in all these other three figures and the corresponding PC values, and I have tried to plot it. The difference between this bottom right figure versus the other figure is that in the other figure, what we do is we also allow for some of the inflexibles, and this is related to maybe the party convergence or them trying to support others. We also allow some of the inflexibles to change their state. And if we allow the inflexibles to change their state, then what happens is that that local cohesion. So with the inflexibles, they also bring in their local support base, for instance. So the campaigns became more effective if these local strategies are also coupled with them. And for them, it can, in fact, go to the other side. But one has to remember that these elections, the objective in elections, really, it's not about disturbing the some steady state or trying to reach a steady state. It's more about, in that transient state, how do you change it just enough? And that is what one observes in all these cases, in a qualitative sense, that if together with these aggressive campaignings, one also allows for inflexibles, some of them, so convert them and include them in their fold, or some other issues which have an opposing effect, some strong issues are present, then the campaigns are going to be more effective. One can do other things with it. Those things I have not shown to you, but what I want to say is that many of the questions that I tried to raise at the beginning, I think with this very simple idea, and it's a very, very simplistic model, it has a lot of assumptions that has gone into it, and one can always argue about those assumptions. But the major observations that I tried to make at the beginning, in terms of obtaining different prevalent states, which could be a function of the social structure, which could be a function of other things that are going on, by varying the contrarian and the inflexibles, one can generate different kinds of social structures. The second thing about party conversions, absent voters, they can automatically be included in a model like this. And what it essentially implies is playing around with the inflexibles. The extreme events that one talks about, and in fact, the two elections, the 2019 elections and the 2020 US elections, these extreme events, in one case, what it does is it supplements the campaign. So that is here what I am trying to show is a negative impact, but it supplements the campaign and it just raises the support base for a limited period of time. That is what is important, and allows the BJP, for instance, to gain a bigger majority. In the other case of US, it is working against all these extreme events, and hence it is bringing it down. Okay. It's acting on the other side. So all these different factors that I tried to mention at the beginning, the point is that they can be included within this model. I'm just not trying to show all the different cases that can be done over here. So I think what I'm going to do is now finally I'm going to conclude. And the conclusion essentially is the things that I have said here, that if you think in terms of cohesive local behavior, then in those cases, and if there is a strong dominance of one party, then the campaigns, aggressive campaigns alone are not sufficient. What it also needs to be supplemented with is other factors, as in the conversion of the support of the other party to their fold. One way in which it could be done is via the crossover of locally significant leaders to the other side. And if there is only mild dominance, then campaigns alone may be effective in those areas. And finally, the thing that I have said, that the model that we have tried to present, in principle, it should be able to capture the behavior of a lot of electorates. So I think I'm going to stop with this. Thanks for listening, and any questions if you have.
Thank you, Mukesh. We are now open to discussion. So anybody who wants to chime in, please do. That'll make it all the more fun. And I can't see much, actually, so I'm flying blind today. Questions? So even with infinite amount of money, you're saying that an election can't be won, right?
Yeah. Let me ask a quick question.
Yes, sure.
How does the interconnectedness of the electorate, let's say, you know, the interaction among the particles, how does that, if you change that level of interaction, would that affect your conclusions? Because you have the influencers or the, you know, the inflexibles who has stronger effects on their surroundings, right? So what if you have actually a weaker interactions between these voters?
It would certainly. However, the amount, I'm not sure. So that I have not done, and I don't know the immediate answer to that. But it should. It should, because it also depends on that part.
Yeah, I just wonder if there's some sort of, quote unquote, phase transition somewhere where you go from one type of behavior to another.
Mm-hmm. Also tied to that, maybe role of longer distance interactions in some areas.
Mm-hmm.
That might increase the rigidity of some areas and might actually have an influence. The nature of society enters through interaction range, right?
Yeah, that is true.
We were actually surprised when a political scientist liked our work. We kind of got totally burned by a physicist at one point who said, oh, this is nonsense work. And we didn't think it was nonsense work. But it looks like many things are possible to do. And if you don't think about politics emotionally, it can be a statistical mechanics subject.
But isn't that the problem, that politics is most of it emotion and only a little bit of actual interest?
Yeah, that's a good point, right? Politics and activism, they're both like that, which is why activism can have negative effects.
Yeah.
And activism is another important process that one can look at with at least, I don't know, I was thinking about that. We haven't done anything yet. But this is a really good group to get some criticism from. And if anybody is interested in anything that Mukesh talked about, please contact us. I mean, we are very open, and that is, we are just playing football, so to speak. Nitant, I thought you had questions. Sorry, go ahead. You are muted. Somebody
just
go ahead.
I just stopped the screen share, that's all.
Oh, okay. Okay. So I don't hear any questions. Assuming there are no questions, then we would close. Thank you very much for being here today. And thank you for joining, for remembering Shurajit. And that was very special. And I will have the recording up before too long. And have a great weekend. And if you have any questions that you thought about, please email Mukesh and me. And Mukesh's email. Mukesh, do you want to write down your email in the chat?
Let's just see. Yeah.
Is this paper out as yet? Because then I can have a look at it more closely. And
yeah, it's been submitted. But one of us can send you a copy.
Okay. Sure.
Yeah, yeah. It'll be very nice to get your input, Shupitin. Yeah, we had to fight with a referee for about a month. Not a referee, an editor. Just to get it in for review. He just refused to review it. So I accused him of picking authors whose work to publish. And that worked. Ah, there is Mukesh's email. So, yes. Please feel free to connect with us. Thank you so much. And if you have